from Wana Brands. Welcome to Enhance Your Life. I'm your host, Jonathan Small, and each week I talk to people from all sorts of professions and backgrounds about how cannabis has enhanced their lives and how this healing plant can enrich your life too. Hey everybody, welcome to the Enhance Your Life podcast. My name is Jonathan Small and I am your host, and I'm really excited about our show today. We have Christian Sederberg, who is a partner and founding member of the national cannabis law firm Vicente Sederberg LLP, and he represents a variety of marijuana businesses, including real estate, private equity, commercial and corporate transaction, and he has been doing so since the inception of Colorado's state-regulated medical marijuana program. Christian is widely recognized as a leader in the cannabis industry. In addition to his client work, he also works closely with government officials, trade associations, members of the business community, and advocates to advance cannabis policy at the local, state, and national level. Today, we're going to talk to Christian about the state of legalization in the U.S. and some efforts by prohibitionists to stop legalization. So Christian, thank you so much for joining the podcast.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Let's talk a little bit about your origin story, because it's very interesting and you've been doing this for a long time and you played really an integral role in the passage and the implementation of Colorado's inaugural legalization of cannabis. So how did you get to that point? How did you get involved in the cannabis industry?
Really a lot of luck, timing luck, make your own luck, who knows. But I met Brian Vicente, my business partner, one of the two founding partners, along with Josh Kappel, back in 2007, 2008, when we shared a ski house together. And Brian was doing some amazing work on drug policy, specifically working with Colorado medical marijuana patients and advocating for their rights and doing impact litigation through a nonprofit, Sensible Colorado, that he formed in 2004, 2005. And, he was friends with some really cool lawyer friends of mine, the do-gooders of my friends, while I was the evil corporate attorney working for a small firm doing really good work and really interesting work. But 2008 hit, Great Recession. I was talking to Brian as we skied and just really fascinated with what he did. Always been really concerned about how the United States treats prisoners generally, but also, the war on drugs specifically. So when Brian got wind and was recruited to help with a state legal medical program in 2009, into the 2010 Colorado legislative session, he approached me and said, "Hey, this could get real, and we really could use someone with your experience and talents." I don't even know if Brian even knew what those were, but Josh Kappel, who was his intern and now our partner and a founding partner of the firm, definitely said, we need someone with a little bit more corporate experience and that can do some more business transactions, since this is probably going to get complicated along with having to meet all the regulatory requirements and whatnot. So I was lucky enough to be brought in into the fold by Brian back then. And we talked about it in 2009, and in May of 2010, we formed the firm. So just celebrated our 11th anniversary, which is pretty wild.
Yeah, that's amazing. How about your personal relationship with cannabis? I mean, are you a consumer of the plant? Were you a consumer of the plant at that time?
It's always funny asking these questions, as we still know that federally it's illegal. But
right, and you're a lawyer.
Right. Fortunately in Colorado, we've had some good ethics opinions on this, and we can do this work. It's a little bit more tricky in some states that are still evolving. But yeah, I've always known cannabis as a less harmful substance than alcohol, as was preached to me by older family members and friends. And yeah, I've enjoyed cannabis for my entire adult life and, possibly before that, but that is the type of activity we're trying to reduce. So, I think it's a good alternative for adults, and for me it works, and but teach their own and everything in moderation.
Yes, for sure. Well, I want to talk to you about moderation specifically. There is a bill, which you're going to talk to us about, that regards potency caps on THC. Many marijuana opponents, people who are opposed to legalization, opposed to the plant in general, are increasingly trying to rein in the industry by proposing things like this, these state-level caps on THC potency. And there's been at least 6 bills that I counted, and there's probably more that have been introduced in state legislators like Florida, Massachusetts, Colorado, Montana, Washington. talk to me about your take on these THC potency caps and, you know, where we are right now, particularly in your state of Colorado.
Sure. So you mentioned the opponents, prohibitionists, you know, there are some people that were a part of this discussion that I really do believe in good faith were coming to the table with concerns about highly potent products. Some of the people in Colorado, some of the families that were impacted, you know, some tragic things have happened, and it's obviously been, you know, life's not easy, and, you know, mental health is a constant struggle in this country, and Colorado specifically, having unfortunately cut some of our funding for mental health over the years. And so I do believe some people were coming in good faith, but it's also been an argument that they've been, the opponents since 2010, since I've been doing this, have been throwing whatever, it's spaghetti at the wall, right? Or whatever the saying is, trying to see what sticks, you know, and they've gone through so many iterations. Now this one has been the one that I think has perhaps stuck a little bit better, because there's an intuitive sort of thing. Oh, well, if it's really strong, you know, it must mean that you're getting more of it. Maybe that means it's more dangerous. There's that sort of intuitive sense. At this point, the science is out. We obviously want to be thoughtful and cautious and protect public health and safety. But, you know, it's our position that just an artificial potency limit and saying, okay, it should be this, it's just bad public policy. And when this issue came up, they actually came out with some language. When it started, it was like 15%, which we said would, okay, that would eliminate how much of the market, 70%, 80%. I do think there is actually a demand now for lower potency products. And certainly when it comes to edibles and other things that I've worked on proactively to improve public safety, be it the candy bars that were segmented into 10 milligram segments with, you know, a stamp showing that each of the, you know, so you could clearly identify if you accidentally grabbed one, or also give people an idea, maybe I shouldn't eat this whole thing. Some people may not recall, but Maureen Dowd, famous columnist, came to Colorado and she made that mistake. And, you know, I mean, she's very unfortunate. Obviously, it doesn't cause permanent damage in a situation like that. But those are the types of things we've been working on for a while. This is a new, it's something that's been around forever, but, you know, there's a lot of inexperienced people. So this is something I've been working on, even with some of the people that were the proponents of this bill, to make good public policy over the last decade. In this particular case, they came out with this 15%. They said, you know, this is a huge problem. They assumed causation when there was some bad outcomes with some kids who had developed mental health issues. People talk about psychotic breaks, and a psychotic break is, you know, sounds very bad, and it can be, but also a psychotic break also means you just have a really bad experience. I mean, I've probably had one or two. I do recall eating an edible that was more potent than I realized, or it was before that we had the consistency, perhaps.
I think we've all had that experience. Yeah, yeah. Many of us have.
Yeah, it's actually been a lot less. But when it comes to kids getting their hands on this, that to me is where we focus. We said, look, we're going to sit down with you at the very beginning of this process. And the Speaker of the House, Alec Garnett, you know, when this bill was going to come out, said, why don't we all talk? There was very little stakeholdering done on the other side to come to us and ask about some of these things and say, what are some solutions? And we agreed to come to the table to talk about what we all care about, which is reducing teens and underage people's access to cannabis and cannabis products. That's exactly the point of regulation, is to put it behind, you know, the counter, ID people, and make sure people that are getting it are supposed to be getting it. So we agreed to come to the table and talk about what solutions we could come up with in order to minimize the number of people underage that are getting these products. And it used to be that, it was the person that was selling it and perhaps selling other things. I don't know. I don't know anyone that's ever got carded when we were in high school and college trying to get your hands on some weed, right? And that's why it's been harder to get alcohol for a long time than it has been to get cannabis. And cannabis products are a new thing. And these highly potent products, even though they've existed for a long time, and highly potent flower has existed for a long time, even though they say it's, oh, this isn't your Woodstock weed or some of those, some of those kind of catchphrases out there. There has been highly potent products. There also has been edibles, and there's also been, you know, concentrates in some form or another for a long time, but we do have highly potent products. So we want to get those, we said, we want to get those out of kids' hands. And we're not saying we don't believe there's any possibility that it could cause some issues, but really the causation is not there. And it doesn't mean that we shouldn't be proactive and be safe. But when you're talking about public health issues, you have to know, how many people is this affecting? You know, you can have a terrible story, but when you talk about public health, you're talking about, you know, what is the larger picture? And for those that have been around Colorado for the last 7 years or 8 years, you may recall some explosions that were happening in Washington state. Some people died when an explosion happened in an apartment complex or a condominium complex. Those explosions were happening here, and it was because people were making concentrates in their garage and using butane through a glass tube. There's these easy to find it on the internet ways to make concentrates. So when you're talking about making public policy and artificially capping potency or doing something, you have to say, well, what are the counter effects going to be? And not only will the counter effects be people making it in the unregulated market, thereby contamination and other issues that, you know, we saw through the vaping crisis, all those were unregulated products that were causing that lung issue with the vaping crisis. And it was the cut of the product that was causing the crisis. So with an unregulated market, you've got problems. And not to mention that whenever you make something illegal and put it back into an illicit market, there is a long trend and tendency, and if not reality, that minorities and poor people are disproportionately impacted by enforcement. So there's a number of public policy issues that just completely missed the mark on. Where we were able to agree is that there were some loopholes, particularly, you know, there's patient, to be a patient in Colorado under our Amendment 20 structure, you only have to be 18 years old. So there's this group of 18 to 20 year olds that can have access to cannabis and cannabis products. And the way the system works is if you're given a recommendation for medical marijuana, then you're allowed to go buy these products. And a medical patient could buy 40 grams a day from one store. They could go to five stores and buy 40 grams a day. So that's one example of some loopholes, and also just making sure the doctors are doing the right things and, you know, making sure that this is actually being treated as medicine. You know, so there, some of those things were clear regulatory issues, and, you know, we were happy to help fix them.
So where are we now with that bill?
The bill's passed. There was no potency cap in there. What it included was some of these loopholes I mentioned, and also a research component where some money is going to be allocated for a group to look at researching, first of all, where are our gaps in research, which there are many. There's also a lot of good research on harms, but there are many gaps on some of the newer types of products and things, and they're going to identify gaps and perhaps research those gaps. We do have some concerns with the way the research language landed. Not everyone's going to be happy with an outcome of the bill. And one of the primary concerns we have is with how the research, you know, is kind of framed. We were hoping for some stronger language around pointing to causality versus correlational studies. So we see this all the time where opponents, prohibitionists, particular ones all the time will take a study and say, oh, look, this study says that marijuana was found in X percent of people who'd committed suicide. And they frame it as marijuana has caused, you know, this is how many people had marijuana in their system. And oh my gosh, this is a huge problem when there's no baseline, there's no correlation, there's no causation, and perhaps not even correlation. So we're, you know, really hoping to get some of that in there. There's other ways to get there. The language that we wanted isn't in there. And then there's also particular concerns around the patient access issues. I know we've heard from some patient groups and doctors groups that have provided medical cannabis to patients in the past, or medical cannabis recommendations, that, you know, this is going to cause a lot of difficulty for people to get their medicine. Some doctors saying, I might need to shut down, you know, my operation. But look, there's a continuing education requirement. There's discussions about how doctors should be inside their specialties. Unfortunately, there's a couple doctors, there's a few doctors, you know, many of them are good, but there's a few doctors that this is an opportunity to, they can say to themselves too, marijuana is relatively benign if used appropriately. So we've seen abuses in the system in the past. Obviously, we got to keep a very close eye to see how it's actually impacting patients. And if there are impacts, you know, I know the speaker has been committed to fixing those things, but we're going to keep a very close eye on it because, you know, you don't want overreach. And again, there was, people have to remember, we started out with a complete cap on, like, all concentrates would have been eliminated. A lot of the flower would have been eliminated, and the products that a lot of patients use would have likely been possibly been pulled out of the market. So yeah, there's some things we don't like and some things we weren't satisfied with, or maybe we're frustrated with, but at the end of the day, we don't have a cap on potency in this state.
Yeah. What about other states? Do you think this legislation will be influential in other states, or is every state sort of have its own story?
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, it's coming up at the federal level too. I mean, but the problem is, it's a lot of times it's people that are talking about it that don't use cannabis, so they don't understand. I mean, a study came out recently that levels of THC don't actually equate to how high someone gets. So if you're talking about THC levels, you're framing it in a debate about driving under the influence, or you're framing it about, you know, how mind blown people could be and not know that they're going to get that experience from such a strong product. Like, these things, they want it to be just like alcohol, but it's not. But even with alcohol, you know, we arrest people.
There must be caps on proof, right? Or in, I'm not familiar with the cap.
So yeah, I mean, so California, I could go to, at least when I was living there, you know, in the 90s, that'll date me, but I could buy whiskey at 7-Eleven, but I couldn't buy Everclear anywhere. Mm. In Colorado, I can buy Everclear, which is grain alcohol, like 90 plus proof alcohol, but I have to go to a liquor store to buy anything above beer or wine, right? So, or I think beer, gosh, I don't even know enough about alcohol, but yeah, they're, you know, so different states have taken different approaches on alcohol and potency. The federal government's taken the approach that they're going to tax it in a way that recognizes that some products are stronger than others. That's something I was strongly advocating for, but politically wasn't palatable, according to the people that were working on it. And, you know, disappointing, but I think that's one solution to this too, is you just tax at a higher rate. If it's a lot more THC in a product, tax it at a little bit higher rate and use that money for things like mental health and, you know, interdiction at an early age, or, you know, kind of smart programs to discourage teens and businesses and anyone else from allowing these products to get in kids' hands. Like, you know, that to me is probably a solution that, you know, maybe Colorado revisits, but certainly federal government and other states. Illinois did something like this already, where they kind of broke it into three categories. With alcohol, we do, you know, beer, wine. Wine actually has multiple categories. And then, you know, hard alcohol has its own, and they're all taxed at different rates based upon really the concept of how potent the products are. But other states that are looking at this, I mean, it hasn't gone, you know, it will certainly come up again in these states and new states. But other states are looking at this, and I think because there's not a lot of data out there, and because, frankly, I think we have very strong arguments on our side on the public policy and public health basis, why it's not a good idea to put stuff back into a prohibition type model, when you can easily, you know, that market will be served whether it's regulated or not. So I think the, you know, the conversation will continue, but hopefully people will look at our bill and say, what are we doing to reduce kids getting their hands on it in the first place? These products aren't intended for kids.
Yeah. And Colorado has always been sort of the pioneer here from the, you know, early legalization to, so it's kind of like what happens in Colorado hopefully happens as a barometer in the rest of the country.
Definitely.
You know, I will confess, I live in a bit of a bubble. You know, I live in California, in Los Angeles, sort of like the hotbed of cannabis consumption. And you live in Colorado and are involved in cannabis legalization and law. And so I don't know too many prohibitionists. So you must have a lot of interaction with them, just given your what you do for a living. And I'm wondering, you know, I'm not to ask you to be a psychologist here, but what really is a concern? I mean, you know, it seems like such a dated concern to me. Like, it seems like we're past that. And you read studies across the country, you know, most of America is really on the legalization side. Like, I think the numbers are like 70%. It's like the one issue that most Americans agree on. Like, there's few issues in the world that Americans agree on. What is your take on where prohibitionists are coming from?
Yeah, no, it's interesting. And there's a bunch of different types, right? So I won't go into my whole tirade about this, but I'll give you some highlights. But I mean, a lot of it is age, right? So if it was banged into your brain for years, and I'm talking now about people in their 70s, 60s, 70s, 80s, maybe not even their 60s anymore, maybe 70s, you know, we have the boomers that were the Woodstock generation, but, you know, people that have been in a model where they were told that marijuana was a gateway drug, that, you know, going back to, you know, grandparents kind of age people, I mean, some of them were told such ludicrous stuff as, you know, and racist jazz singers or raping white women. I mean, that goes back to some of the early days of prohibition, just completely misrepresenting what was happening. And then, you know, dope, you know, my grandma would always say dope, you know, that the kids are dope smokers. And, you know, and the idea that, you know,
madness era.
Yeah. Caricature of, like, you know, you picture like the wino in a cartoon, right? In the gutter, or the dirty coat and wine bottle with two X's on it or whatever. I mean, that's kind of how the cannabis consumer has been portrayed in general. You know, even if it's funny, you know, Cheech and Chong or other things, it's kind of like this stoner thing. And I think a lot of older people they think of it as it's something that people use that makes you lazy, makes you not productive, and leads you to using harder drugs and destroys people's lives. And so those folks, I don't know that we're ever going to change them, mm-hmm. you know? And unfortunately, I think, you know, the president comes from that generation too. And, you know, I'm not saying he's not open-minded on a number of things, and he can evolve, and he has evolved. But, you know, it's just tough when for years and years and years you heard these things. That goes for law enforcement too, right? If you've been arresting people for decades, it's a tough thing to come to grips with that maybe that wasn't the right thing to do. You were doing your job, but not the right thing to do. But really the younger generation, Republicans, Democrats, folks in law enforcement across the board are much more supportive of legalization. But then you also have, you know, what my friend who's a parent, I'm not a parent, but told me, you know, he's like, it's a requirement of parenthood that you become a hypocrite. The level of what sort of hypocrite you are depends, but, you know, a lot of people I know that smoked weed and other things, you know, as soon as it could be a possibility that could, you know, their kids could get it at school, you know, it's like, oh, I don't know about legalization. I'm getting kind of worried about some of this stuff. And, you know, I'm not knocking them. I get it. But what they have to understand is that prohibition only breeds more people targeting your kids. And then I also think that, unfortunately, and I will not use my more sort of cynical view of some of the addiction industries, you know, addiction treatment industries, tactics and other things. But, you know, there's people that, you know, there's a monetary interest in the private prison system. We saw this probably play out in some states that there was resistance by peculiar organizations to advancing medical or adult use cannabis. The private prison system benefits off of how many people are in beds, and cannabis is a pipeline to get people in those beds over time, and particularly in some southern states. And then the addiction treatment industry, right? They get paid for, you know, it's funny when you see someone who got caught with weed, and it's like, oh, I had to say I was a weed addict, and then I went to treatment, right? And I had to go to treatment. That's what the judge ordered me to do, or that's how I avoided a more serious sentence or whatever. But like, there's a monetary interest. And then, like I said, that's the more cynical view. But the less cynical view, one of our colleagues, Andrew Livingston, at our firm, whose dad is a trauma surgeon, you know, he's kind of joking about how he's like, look, if I was in charge of making public policy, ladders and overhead limb cutting devices would be illegal, because those are the most dangerous things I've ever seen. Because his lived experience is that people coming in who've fallen off of ladders and injured themselves or killed themselves, unfortunately. But obviously a policy from that perspective where we should prohibit ladders wouldn't make no sense. You know, maybe it's not the perfect example, but I think it gives you a sense of what I'm saying about how people perceive things. So, you know, you start to see kids coming in have developed a dependency on cannabis, you know, and look, all these weed advocates, they say there's no addiction, no dependency. It's not true. We've acknowledged that people can develop a dependency, you know, on cannabis, but guess what? People develop a dependency on looking at their phone and Instagram, Facebook. They develop it on sugar. They develop it on anything that's going to help you, you know, anything that causes your brain to release the chemicals, dopamine and others that you get pleasure from, has the potential for abuse. So the difference is that with alcohol, you go off alcohol, you can die, right? With cannabis, you know, if you have developed dependency, mild symptoms coming off, doesn't mean I don't take it seriously, but there is something to be said there. But I just have a hard time with some of the addiction specialists that are, you know, out there saying this is going to ruin the world. And then, you know, it's going to lead to all these bad outcomes for these poor kids. When I'm like, yeah, but you know, you're the one who's made kids come in and admit to having a problem when they don't. And I know many of them. I wasn't one of them because I just didn't happen to get caught. But like, it's disingenuous, you know, and it doesn't create good public policy, but it's easy to scare people.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know why the message doesn't get across that the more you regulate it and the more it becomes legal in a national way, the less likely that you're going to get these kind of gummy gate kind of situations where kids are buying this underground, you know, cannabis that looks like Starburst or, you know, Sour Patch Kids or whatever, which is all stuff that's coming from the black market. And the black market is able to create that stuff because we're still so regulated, where there's still so much prohibition in the legal market, and that, you know, the black market can still flourish. So it seems like me, the natural answer to this, and I'm just being an armchair politician here, is to just legalize it across the board and then regulate it that way rather than kind of there's always going to be this demand for cannabis. You're not going to stop that. We kind of learned this on the war on drugs. So yep. By driving it underground, it's going to perpetuate some of these problems. Some of the biggest problems we've seen in cannabis, like Vapegate and now this stuff with kids getting into their parents' cannabis stash, seems to be mostly focused on the illicit market, mostly the stuff that's coming out of the illicit market.
Yeah, I think in vape, you know, you brought Vapegate. It's a great example. When they actually got to the bottom of what was causing it, which was one of the things that it was being mixed with, I think it was four of the five. If there was five, I think I'm 90% sure this is right, but four of the five adult use states at the time had lower incidences on average of that vape injury or vape illness, whatever you want to call it, than the national average. The one state that didn't allow those products in their market. And when we look at it, it turned out that it was unregulated products being adulterated with a substance that was illegal, and Colorado could make quick regulatory changes as needed. But also that just wasn't being used because it was known to be either not a good product to use, or people might know, I don't think anyone knew it would cause what it caused, but people just knew it wasn't good. Whereas it's unregulated, look what happens. Let me use another example, opiates. So interestingly, during the opiate phase two or three of the opiate crisis, one of the solutions was like, well, we just got to reduce what the medical use for opiates is, and so they did. Well, guess what happened? People found other things, you know, starting with heroin, but then realizing fentanyl, a synthetic version, which everyone knows has wreaked havoc on our society, the world, but particularly the United States. And that was a result of the reduced allowance for doctors, direct result of it. And so what happens is, you know, you take it out of a regulated market. I'm not saying that there was a better solution back then, but the unintended consequence of, oh, we're just going to walk back what medical use is allowed, actually resulted in an explosion of fentanyl overdoses because of how much more potent it actually was. So you're trying to get rid of potent products, or you do something and then you're going to put product in the market. Yeah, I mean, there's so many unintended consequences. And like the other side, prohibitionists, whatever you're going to call them, can impugn my character, call me a, you know, say I don't care about kids, all these different things. And at the end of the day, I go to sleep at night because I know I care enough to do the research and think about these things in a way that will help improve lives. You know, I've got a sister who's a teacher. This is my legacy, and I'm from Colorado. I grew up in Denver. I'm not trying to screw up our society. I think we've made it actually a lot better. And when there are problems, I have an actual track record of helping to fix them with whoever is going to work with me. And sometimes it's the other side, sometimes it's not, but it's pretty obvious when, to me, on a lot of, especially the national organizations that are talking about these things and creating whatever the newest outrage that they want to create, they don't necessarily care. They really just want to find a way to slow down the industry, embarrass the industry, try to wreck the industry. And so it's whatever sounds good and sounds like, okay, that's going to make it harder on them. They don't like it. Well, then we're for that. Whereas we're saying, how do we actually solve problems? And again, there are people, and even people in Colorado, actually, especially people in Colorado, that are credible on the other side. And frankly, we need a credible opposition. What we don't need is people that are just faux outrage, because in their heart of hearts, they do believe marijuana is evil for whatever reason. And maybe it's personal experience, maybe not, but like, or maybe it's just how they butter their bread or whatever. I don't know. But when it comes to real solutions, I think we've made a bunch of significant progress.
Well, I thank you for fighting the good fight. And it's good to have a smart person and a person with your kind of passion, you know, on the side of cannabis. To make a prediction with all these forces kind of up against, you know, national legalization, you even mentioned, you know, even though President Biden isn't, you know, necessarily against marijuana, he's definitely of a certain generation. It definitely does not seem to be first and foremost in his mind and on his agenda. You know, we had the Safe Banking Act passed Congress, but it's kind of stuck in the Senate. There's a lot of legislation that kind of gets stuck. Do you have any predictions about whether, you know, we're going to be legal federally in the next few years, or does it even matter at this point? I mean, maybe the way it's happening is the way it's going to happen, where it's going to be a state-by-state decision, and each state is going to have to deal with it on their own merits. I mean, it'd be much easier if it was a federal system and everybody could get banking and it was a legitimate industry that was regulated. But what is your prediction here?
Sure. I'd start by saying the reason it really matters at this point too. Well, two reasons. One, even though the vast majority of arrests for marijuana occur at the state and local level, there still is the across the board federal scheduling system that makes it a crime in every single state, regardless of your state laws, to possess or consume cannabis. And that always and has historically, and unfortunately will probably continue to disproportionately impact communities of color and poor communities. So that change is incredibly important. And also, as we've evolved from, let's stop having people be arrested, you know, sort of where what our focus was during the 2012 campaign, we now have opportunity for people to, especially people that were impacted by the war on drugs detrimentally, to participate in this new economy, in this new industry. That's the social equity items that you're seeing in bills where New Jersey, New York, and, you know, Illinois, like everywhere where there's new legislation that is front and center. And if those small businesses, small startups don't have access to banks, and or the bank accounts are incredibly expensive, or they might lose them at any time, and they pay this disproportionate tax rate, those people are not going to be able to achieve, you know, and create opportunity for themselves and their families and their communities with those very significant things that are impeding progress. So that's why it's important. But as to when Booker, Schumer, Wyden, you know, that bill that we've been hearing was going to come out since February or March. And I, you know, give them a little bit of crap, but, you know, they're working hard and obviously there's a lot of stuff going on. So now we're hoping to see something soon this summer, maybe later this summer, around August, around the recess. That's going to be a major point in this discussion. If we can get, obviously, with the 60 vote requirement in the Senate, it's still going to be hard. We don't even have all the Democrats necessarily on board, but we do have some Republicans. And I think that there's a very real chance that, you know, Senator Schumer's bill, he's the leader, you know, could get some traction. It just kind of depends on who's going to come to the table on the right side of the aisle. And frankly, who's, you know, is there room to negotiate any of the, you know, the social justice, criminal justice, social equity provisions that are in there in a manner similar to, say, the First Step Act, which was the comprehensive, you know, criminal justice reform bill where neither side got everything they wanted, but we passed groundbreaking legislation that improved a lot of lives. So I think that there's a good chance we could see something, if it's not comprehensive in this Congress, so by the end of 2022, something around banking or you know, some other, you know, hopefully it's expungement, or we can get some things that are not controversial. It starts to get controversial when you have law enforcement Republicans, and I'm not begrudging them, that you're like, wait a minute, these people they didn't have a license, and these other people went through all this stuff, this hell to get a license, and now we want to get priority, or we want to give them loans. It doesn't compute, right? And we got to change those minds and help them understand that the system as it has existed for a century has, you know,
rigged against it.
Has destroyed those, you know, not destroyed the communities in their entirety, but has destroyed lives in those communities. In some cases, really created such massive detriment to those communities. So, like, yeah, there is an opportunity, but also, in my opinion, an obligation to make sure that they are able to participate in this industry. So, anyways, you saw my mini pitch there for, you know, getting some moderate Republicans over, you know. But I'm bullish on something happening for sure. I don't know how broad or how far it will go. And that's just step one. And, you know, we're not going to stop until we're at the point that, you know, there's no one with a record, no one getting arrested. And my business partner and my, you know, our firm considers anyone with a record and with, you know, nonviolent offense that has anything to do with cannabis to be a political prisoner, regardless if they're behind any actual bars. And, you know, I think that's the spirit that all of the, you know, everyone needs to take. And if, by the way, if you're in the business, you're an activist. I don't want to hear anyone say, I'm not a business person, I'm not an activist. If you're in this business, you're an activist, whether you like it or not.
Yeah. Well, wouldn't that be amazing if the one thing that the Republicans and Democrats could agree on is some sort of cannabis reform? That would be incredible.
It's not far off the mark.
Not far off the mark.
You said it. Like, look at the polling. I don't know if you pulled up the sky is blue or the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, if you get those numbers.
I know. You know, it's pretty universal. All right. Well, thank you so much, Christian, for taking the time to explain this in such a compelling way. And I really appreciate all the work you're doing on behalf of those wrongly accused and those who just want to enjoy this plant in peace.
safely. A lot going on. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, you know, the work being done in D.C. by, you know, all the advocacy groups, the Drug Policy Alliance, Normal, you know, the Minority Cannabis Business Association, and, you know, the United States Cannabis Council, which I'm a part of now, and NCIA, these legacy organizations. I mean, a lot of really good work being done, and, you know, in some cases, thankless work, but, you know, really, really proud of what people are doing out there, and really proud of the direction we're going, but it's not over yet, and, you know, we got to get it done.
Enhance Your Life is brought to you by Wana, the number one infused product in North America. Wana's entire process is designed to deliver the same great experience time after time. They have spent years fine-tuning their recipes so that their products are delicious, consistent, and potent. For more information, check out WanaWellness.com. That's Wana, W-A-N-A, wellness.com.